good evening, everybody. Good evening, everybody. You just heard from the late, great Sam Cook, who left us too early. There's an excellent documentary about his life on Netflix. So welcome to the second webinar that the Petey Greene Program is hosting for our Fall 2020 Justice Education Series. My name is Mako Faniel. I am the Director of Tutor Training and Justice Education for the Petey Greene Program. It looks like we have about 120 people so far that have joined us tonight for our Approaches to Reentry webinar. So in a few minutes, I'll stop talking after I introduce you to our moderator, who will then introduce you to our esteemed panelists. But first, I want to establish the occasion for tonight. So for our agenda tonight, we'll start with some background on the Petey Greene program, since not everyone that's on with us tonight knows fully what we do. Then we'll spend the bulk of our time with our guest learning more about the challenges, barriers, and collateral impacts of incarceration, but more importantly, learning about the different approaches that reentry programs take to help returning citizens and their families thrive. Then we'll open it up to the audience to ask questions, and then we'll close with a survey that we're asking you all to complete to help us do our work better. So before we continue our program, I think it's important for us to take a pause to honor the life of Walter Wallace, but also the legions of others whose lives have been taken as a result of state-sanctioned and vigilante violence. And so let's take about 30 seconds for a moment of silence. And then we will continue with the order of our program. So I know that 30 seconds is not enough, but we want to, as an education justice organization, it's important that we pause to, reflect on the injustice that continues, that, really pushes us all to do this work. So I know most of us either have our phones in our hand or close by. And so I'm gonna ask you to pick up your phones, go to Twitter or go to Facebook, and tell everybody in your network how excited you are to be attending this webinar. And make sure that when you do so, that you use the hashtag PGPJusticeEd. PGP, of course, stands for Petey Greene Program. So this is the hashtag that you should use on all of social media platforms tonight to comment about all the good stuff you're gonna learn from our panelists. So again, that hashtag is PGPJusticeEd. So I wanna now briefly introduce y'all to the work of the Petey Greene Program. So we are an educational justice and educational management nonprofit with a twofold mission. We support the educational goals of incarcerated and formerly incarcerated people enrolled in high school equivalency or college courses while on the inside or associated with a reentry program. So we exist to help system impacted people reach their freedom dreams through education. We do this by providing trained college and community volunteers who serve as tutors for incarcerated and formerly incarcerated learners. But we don't stop there. So not only do our volunteers learn how to be effective tutors, they also participate in learning that helps them understand the injustices manifest in the carceral system. We do this because we want a world where all those who have been denied education or that have been harmed by the carceral state have access to high quality academic programs. But we also do this because, you know, volunteering shouldn't just be a passive experience where you build social capital that you can put on your resume. It should be a transformative experience for volunteers also. And so we imagine a world where volunteers and the incarcerated learners are joining together in a movement to reimagine justice and freedom. So for the last 12 years, we have operated the largest multi-state tutoring program in jails, prisons, and detention centers. We were actually on target to continue on this path, but 2020 created an opportunity for us to remix what we do. So we are now supporting returning citizens pursuing academic credentials through a reentry program. We launched a college bridge program to help those who already have a high school equivalency credential who will be going to college. We're providing writing and reading support to help them make that transition. We are now doing virtual tutoring. And we also formalized the work that we've been doing on campuses for many years into a justice education series, which is why we're here right now. And why did we do this? So, of course, COVID forced all of us to change how we do our work and live our lives. For prison education programs, COVID pushed us out of jails and prisons. And so when COVID hit in March, we began to think about how we could still support the educational goals of system impacted people. We reached out to reentry programs, and we also began to think about how we can do this virtually. We also expanded to reentry because we realized that we can't actualize our vision if we're only supporting in-prison programming, because there are thousands of people who have been denied education, who are returning home, and who need educational support. And this is definitely the case as many states are moving to decarcerate. The need for educational support for returning citizens increases. And I'm about to shut up. Let me kind of explain what the Justice Education Series is, and I'll introduce our moderator. So for a long time, each semester, our field staff or campus-based Petey Greene organizations typically host about 30 different events on different campuses focused on social justice and systemic change, so that volunteers and the broader campus communities can understand the context which produced mass incarceration and grapple with how to approach systemic change. So because of COVID, we've now formalized these events in the form of webinars, open to all volunteers regardless of their region or university, and open to the public. So this semester, our Justice Education Series is focused on expanding understanding of the carceral state and its relationship to education, and also helping us understand reentry. So we hosted a carceral state and education webinar on October 8th. Then our next one is reentry and education, a student perspective. And for tonight, we are talking about approaches to reentry. And this is important because we recognize that, you know, education may not be the first thing that someone pursues when they are returning home. There are a multitude of needs that have to be met. And so we want to talk about those approaches to reentry. And so moderating tonight is Nia Hill. Nia is a recent graduate of Howard University, where she earned a degree in accounting. She's now a graduate student at Columbia University, majoring in nonprofit management. Next fall, Nia will be a consulting analyst for Deloitte. And this fall, Nia is a volunteer for the Petey Greene Program, where she supports students with the Youth Services Center. So Nia, please take over, and we are ready to get going.
Lovely, thank you for that, Makar. I really appreciate that. Hi, everybody. It's great to be here with you all tonight. I am very excited about the conversation we're going to have. And with that being said, I'm going to introduce our panelists because they have so much to say. So first, we're going to start off with Heather Gatos. Representing the Center of Health and Justice Transformation is Heather Gatos, who is the Reentry Project Director for the Center for Health and Justice Transformation at the Merriam Hospital. Heather's work at the center helps address the gaps between RIs, Rhode Island's criminal justice system, justice-involved individuals and families, and the community providers who serve these populations. She serves as the coordinator of the RI Reentry Collaborative, which is a new initiative designed to serve people transitioning from prison back to RI communities with the long-term aims of sustaining reentry partnerships, fostering collaborative case planning, improving the efficiency of community-based services, and promoting best practices for working with justice-involved adults. Thank you so much, Heather, for joining us tonight. Next is Nomi Sulfur from Voices of Reentry. Nomi is a writer and editor with a strong commitment to telling stories of overlooked people. She has over two decades experience developing content and managing complex communications projects and events. Her work includes profiles of returning citizens written under the Federal Improved Reentry Education Grant. Nomi has taught courses at Boston University, Harvard University, Framingham State University, and MCI Framingham. She has MA and PhD degrees in English and American Literature from Boston University, and a BA in English from Brandeis University. Thank you, Nomi, for joining us tonight. On to Jeffrey Abramowitz. Jeffrey, or Jeff, is the Executive Director of Reentry Service of Looking Forward Philadelphia. Jeff proudly sits on the Executive Board of the Coalition on Basic Adult Education, COABE, where he serves as the chair of the Literacy Behind and Beyond the Walls Committee, was appointed to the Pennsylvania Reentry Council, and serves as chairman of the Employment Committee and co-chairs the Reentry Committee for the PA Workforce Development Board. Jeff is also active in the Philadelphia Reentry Coalition. He serves on the Board of Directors of Community Forgiveness and Restoration, a member of Nationswell Council, an advisory board member of Philadelphia Petey Greene Program. Jeff is presently a LINCS reviewer, Literacy Information and Communication System, resource collection for the Department of Education, and serves on the National Association of State Directors of Education, Barbara Brush Foundation Criminal Justice Work Group. Lastly, we have Topeka K. Sam, who serves as the founder and executive director of the Ladies of Hope Ministries at Hope House. She serves on the board of directors for Grassroots Leadership, Coalition for Public Safety and the Marshall Project. Since her release from federal prison on May 5th, 2015, Topeka has been awarded many memberships and honors, including 2015 Beyond the Bars Fellow and director of hashtag Dignity Campaign for hashtag Cut 50, where she led the bipartisan national effort to pass 20 pieces of legislation restoring the dignity for incarcerated women. She has worked and continues to work selflessly and relentlessly in her fight for the dignity, decriminalization, and decarceration of women and girls. Again, thank you all so much for joining us tonight. We really appreciate you all taking the time out of your busy schedules to have this important conversation. So we will now give you all some time to introduce yourselves if I left anything out. And also tell us how you got into the work of reentry as well as your organization. So that being said, maybe we can start with Nomi.
Thank you, Nia. As you mentioned, I'm a writer, an editor, and a teacher, and I got into the work a few years ago when I had the opportunity to write a series of profiles of reentry programs around the country for a federal Improved Reentry Education Grant that my then employer was leading. Interviewing returning citizens and people who developed and worked in the reentry programs was really eye-opening. I knew a lot about mass incarceration, but virtually nothing about reentry. The more I learned, the more I saw the vast gaps in knowledge and understanding between formerly incarcerated people and the organizations that support and empower them, and a pretty large pool of non-incarcerated people who could be supporting successful reentry but aren't, because reentry is largely invisible to them.
Thank you so much. Topeka, would you like to go next?
Sure. Thank you, Nia, and thank you, Mako, and the Petey Greene Program for including me in this conversation. So I came to this work, you mentioned from my bio, through my incarceration. I knew that when I was coming home from prison that my transition would be fairly easy. You know, I joke sometimes and say when I came in, I went in, it was an iPhone 3, and I came out and it was an iPhone 5. So much in the world did not change except some apps and a few updates. And I had technology skills, education, and other things prior to going to prison, and a huge support system. But many of the women that I had met along my journey were in fear of coming home, didn't know where they would go, subjected to sexual trauma and violence again, trafficking, substance misuse because they didn't have resources, you know, trying to find their children, didn't know where they were because they lost their parental rights, not because they wanted to, but because they didn't even maybe get a court document while they were inside. And so that's actually what just inspired me to begin to do the work, because I knew that there would be a huge gap for services for women and girls. And that while we pass legislation and we're looking to decarcerate and change the conditions of confinement, that while doing that, when people are released from prison, if they have nowhere safe to live, no food in their stomach, and no sustainable and equitable opportunities through education and employment, we are setting people up to fail. And so the organization was birthed in 2017, and that's why we're here.
Excellent, thank you. Heather?
Hello, everybody. Thanks for allowing me to be in this space. It's an honor to be speaking with and to everybody here. I came into this work primarily as a service provider. I worked in the nonprofit community in Providence, Rhode Island for 16 years and worked very intensely with gang members and victims of street violence, and really quickly became well-versed in the injustices of the justice system, and used that as my experience to, or as the reasoning really for going back to graduate school and getting my master's in social work, and really looking at the history of reentry in Rhode Island and looking at best practices across the country, how different states and jurisdictions are really looking at not only individual supports and how to keep people from being reincarcerated, but then also how do systems transform and work more holistically to meet the needs of people so that they don't get trapped in the cycle of incarceration. So the organization that I work for is the Center for Health and Justice Transformation, and we really focus on the intersection of public health and criminal justice, trying to look at the social determinants of health and taking a health equity approach to not only reentry, but then also to statewide planning efforts, decriminalization efforts, and kind of all the different pieces of the justice system. I think, you know, the approach that we take and that I've taken to my work here at the center is very much that it's a collective impact on all parts of society. There's not just one piece of our communities that's impacted by incarceration. And so reentry particularly is a topic where you really, in order to be successful, all sectors, all parts of our communities really need to be engaged and involved to have healthy, thriving communities and individuals. So thank you for having me here. I'm really glad to be here tonight.
Love that. And we'll definitely be touching on that part of reentry throughout the night. But last but definitely not least, Jeff.
Well, so thank you very much. Thanks, Petey Greene. I'm really excited to be here for many reasons, but I guess I can pinpoint the exact date when my journey started into reentry. It was March 12, 2012. I stood in a federal courtroom in Philadelphia, and I was a trial lawyer for 20 years in Philadelphia. And for the first time in my life, I stood in a courtroom and in front of the media, my family and friends, colleagues and others. And I wasn't there as an attorney. I was there as a defendant. On that day, I was sentenced to 5 years in federal penitentiary and came home a little over 5 years ago today. So my journey started the first day that I went in, and it hasn't ceased up to the present time. My inside experience in prison opened my eyes up, but it was returning home back to Philadelphia in a halfway house and in a shelter that really opened a whole door of a new world that I just never really understood. I returned to Philadelphia in one of the most, one of the most poverty-stricken areas of our country. And also it was replete with gun violence and continues to this day. But I didn't understand the challenges of the men and women that I was incarcerated with, that were Black and Brown, that were being impacted by our criminal justice system. And navigating the halfway house system was something I had a real challenge doing. But I was able to start teaching GED math at a minimum wage when I came home, and quickly made my way up to a director of a Title II adult literacy agency. And the journey continued through Just Leadership as a fellowship that I had with them, and then navigating my way home now to be able to do work both at a state, federal, and local levels to actually make change happen in the reentry space. So I'm really proud to be here and humbled by it as well.
Yeah. Nia, before we go on, I wanna make sure that we're missing one panelist right now. John D. Jarrell, who is the program coordinator for the Fresh Start at your library program in New Jersey. Real innovative program where it connects returning citizens to local libraries to help them with case management, but also employment, education, and also public health. And so the library is a site for navigating other public and resources.
Thanks for that, Mako. So also thank you to all our panelists for those powerful introductions. We are very happy for you all to be here. So that being said, our next question has to do with reentry and also definitions. So we know that the definition of reentry varies depending on the person, the institution, and different parts of society. So I think it's important for us to ask you all, what is reentry and who is reentry? And we can start with Topeka.
I would say, well, thank you for the question. And I would say that what is reentry, or how about, I'm not even gonna say what, I'll say when reentry starts, is what Jeff said. I remember being in federal prison and seeing a sign on the bulletin board that said, you know, the first day of reentry is your first day here, basically. And when I looked at it, I said, all right, well, understanding what reentry was, reentering into society, post-incarceration, you know, in theory, but reentry never really talked about the other things that people need, right? Like the housing piece of it, the reunification of families, what are the collateral consequences to reentry? Voting rights, what are they? Do you still have them, depending on what state you're going in, what system you're coming from? And so when I think about reentry, I think, yes, it comes from, you know, this idea of coming back into the world, back into society. Do I feel that when we're thinking about reentering, that people are actually like returning citizens, and you know, there's different terms that go along with it. I don't necessarily agree with all of them, because many people are coming back and they don't necessarily have all of their rights back. They are still struggling. I mean, every time I leave the country and I come back, despite the fact that I've completed all of my supervision, I still get stopped every single time. Even to the point where I'm asked to strip, I have to call for a supervisor because I refuse. So I think that, you know, the issues that people are facing and the ideas that once you're released from prison, Basically, that's it. And that it's left up to the individual in order to re-enter and transform their life, I think is a huge burden or additional burden, considering you still are on parole or probation, federal supervision for some. You still have to navigate additional authoritative systems. So, I mean, it's hard. I'm not, I guess, an advocate of the word reentry. Ms. Gail Muhammad, who has, Women Who Never Give Up in New Jersey always speaks about like new entry or no entry. Like, you know, we want to make sure that people actually don't have to technically re-enter into a community or society that they once left from, but more so that we are creating programs, a diversion program, so people don't have to go to prison at all. So they have a well-resourced in order to help them to transform their life and have equitable opportunities.
And whoever wants to go next can just hop in.
So I guess I can jump in. I think there's just not a good term. I agree with Topeka. There's not a good term for reentry, because I'm going to tell you quite frankly that the men and women that go through our criminal justice system are always going to be in somehow identified by their number that brought them into the system. And for me, reentry is just a point in time. It's a point in time where a person starts his life over again, where things start happening, and then they're given the opportunity to, as David Brooks has a great book called The Second Mountain, where he talks about, you know, we go through life trying to climb one mountain and then something sends us back down. And life is all about the second climb that you do, because that's where all the lessons come in. So that's really what it's about. It's about taking everything you've learned from your journey and then applying it so you can have that second or third or fourth or fifth opportunity to get it right and to figure out what makes you happy and successful and get a sustainable job and all those things that come along with that.
I would add also, I think, beyond just kind of like the term of reentry, that it's what are people reentering back into, and what were the conditions that caused their incarceration in the first place? So really making sure that when people think about the term reentry, that they're really conscious of the fact that so much of the problems that exist in society are reflected in our criminal justice system and the way in which we incarcerate folks and the disproportionality of which people are incarcerated. And so really making sure that the reentry process is that as part of the reentry and who reentry is for, that acknowledging that the societies and the communities that people are reentering are partly who it is for. Of course, it's about the individual that has been incarcerated, but it's also about different parts of our structures and our systems working better than they had before, which typically isn't somebody's experience. There's just coming back out into the same community that's structured the same way. So there's like a structural piece to reentry beyond the individual experience that I think needs to be recognized when we're thinking and talking about the term.
And I would just add, I want to build on what Heather said, because I think I wanted to go into this the area of the community and the community's role in reentry. And so I think there's both the structural questions, and then there's a question of what does the community of non-incarcerated people, what's their responsibility and their role in reentry? And that's really where my project sits. It's at the intersection, or it's where impacted people, returning citizens, and the community meet, and in that, you know, where we're trying to create dialogue. But I think for people who aren't directly impacted, reentry is really about being part of a community undertaking. It's taking responsibility for undoing some of the harms of mass incarceration and by supporting and the criminalization of Black and Brown and poor people. And so for non-incarcerated people, reentry is about their own education, about taking shared responsibility and seeking ways to contribute to empowering returning citizens and helping, being part of the solution of creating pathways to successful reentry. And that that might look different for different people. For some people, that might mean personally going out and volunteering, getting involved with the Petey Greene program or with any other, you know, of the many wonderful programs out there. For other people, it might be learning about the structural issues that Heather was talking about and, you know, lobbying or getting involved in making structural change. But I really think that reentry is not just for formerly incarcerated people and their families, but it's for the entire community. And it's really important to broaden the conversation to include the entire community.
So thank you all for those, for introducing yourselves and also providing us with kind of a framework to understand what reentry is. I think my next question is kind of long, but I pose this question because I don't know if we have enough conversations about the realities of what post-incarceration life is or the realities of, you know, what it would mean, what decarceration means for formerly incarcerated people and their families. And so there was this book published about 10 years ago that I believe it's partially why we're having this conversation today. So Michelle Alexander published this book called The New Jim Crow, Mass Incarceration in the Age of Colorblindness. And one of the things that she argues is that the final stage of punishment process that creates a racialized caste system of system-impacted people is called invisible punishment. She describes this stage as the manifold restrictions, barriers, challenges, sanctions, and discrimination that folks face when leaving jails, prisons, and other places of confinement. And so at the Petey Greene Program for our pre-service training for volunteers, they learn a little bit about the long hand of punishment and how that creates barriers and challenges for returning citizens and their families. We do this because we want them to understand how education might mitigate some of these challenges, and also to help volunteers understand the impact of punishment on formerly incarcerated people and their families, and how the barriers to reentry might impact their academic pursuits. So with this question, this is for all the panelists. I'm hoping that you could talk about two things, and they're connected. Can you talk a little bit more about the challenges, barriers, and collateral impact of incarceration? And then connect that to how your organization specifically addresses them in your approach to reentry. So put more simply, how does your organization approach reentry and why? And I guess we can get started with Heather.
Sure. So I think the way that we really approach reentry is kind of, again, this collective impact approach. So really recognizing that successful reentry spans across all sectors, recognizing that people are whole human beings with whole needs. And so that means that when you're thinking about reentering from prison, you're thinking about housing, employment, education, behavioral health, mental health, and substance use. Family reunification, your overall physical health, your ability to connect with viable income, and just the human services and education and transportation, right? So it touches all aspects of society, and where I work personally, we don't provide direct services. We are kind of the conduit and the advocates for those organizations that are doing the direct service work. Also then trying to work on a more collaborative way in Rhode Island to address some of the policy and advocate for some of the larger systemic gaps that exist. And we do that through building collaborations. So we're doing that from both a systems level and a community level, building and pointing out the gaps across different state agencies and government entities that can and should care about reentry because they're already inherently serving this population, whether you're talking about, beyond just the traditional criminal justice pieces, you're talking about the education system, employment system, human services, right? People that are getting SNAP, people are getting healthcare, like public health is across all of that. And so so we're really trying to make sure that government understands how, in Rhode Island particularly, a third of our population is justice involved. So any sector, right, can't effectively address their goals unless they're considering that. And then same time on the community side, making sure that those community providers and the families and individuals impacted by the justice system have an organized approach and place to go and clarity about what the resources are and what the facts are and that there's transparency. So really organizing on the community side as well to make sure that those can navigate the reentry system better than it currently exists. I currently coordinate a new initiative that's called the Reentry Collaborative, and it's right now a partnership between four community-based organizations that really take a case management approach to reentry and a strength-centered, individualized approach. So we're not trying to put people into boxes or give a cookie cutter approach, but really meet people where they're at and say, what do you need and how can we help you? Regardless of what happened prior to your release, who are the people now in your life that are your positive supports, and how can we help you make goals to continue to keep you from being reincarcerated, essentially? So that's like on the ground level what our approach is, and really like taking into consideration again that like what even the research and the science says isn't necessarily applicable to everybody in the same way, and so really meeting people where they're at with what their needs are and making sure that there's a network in the community for people to get those needs and supports met.
Right, so, before I go on, I want to, Heather, can you extend on that? Because you all have a public health approach, and I think that I think that's unique. And when we were talking about, why public health is something that I never considered. So can you talk a little bit more about, I guess, like briefly about the organization's like founding and like why like the healthcare, the public health needs of the persons that you're working with.
Sure. Yeah. We recognize that the communities that people are coming from prior to incarceration are already disproportionately suffering from public health issues related to public health. So that there's the disparities that we see in our healthcare system are mirrored in our criminal justice system. And they're coming from communities typically that already have overall poor health and access to care, access to kind of the basic services. And so recognizing that taking the public health framework, public health again is multi-sector. And so recognizing that the health and success of everybody in our community improves the health and success of our community. So whether that means that you're the average Joe or you're somebody that's reentering, we have to care about all of those folks equally and recognize the inequities in access to care, access to opportunity that inherently exist. So I'm not sure, did that answer your question?
Yeah, it did. As I know you started off with focusing on HIV and now it's kind of, because you're connected to a hospital, right?
Yeah, yep. So we're founded by a doctor who works as an infectious disease doctor that works at the prison in Rhode Island, seeing patients regularly, really to first started out treating folks with HIV and AIDS, and we've now been really active in the opioid use disorder epidemic in Rhode Island. And, you know, again, making sure that people's transition, that transition out of prison, that the continuity of care for people's chronic health conditions, which are incarcerated folks are disproportionately experiencing as well. Prior to incarceration, right, they're coming in from unhealthier communities. So they're already, you know, coming out with that, those burdens. So really making sure that somebody's primary care needs are met is also, it's just amazing to think about the average kind of health literacy of the average person is fairly low, you know, and then you add on top of it all of the competing needs and requirements of reentry. People aren't not necessarily going to like be able to just gravitate towards what they need to address their health conditions. So we're really looking at the holistic approach to somebody's health and making sure that the physical and mental health and behavioral health issues that somebody are experiencing are not the driving force for anything related to reincarceration.
Thank you, Heather. Topeka?
So you have to pardon me because I was over here looking at, I need you to reframe the question for me.
Yeah, so if you can talk to me about, you know, what are those challenges, collateral impacts of incarceration, mm-hmm. and how your organization specifically approaches, you know, reentry.
Absolutely. So, I mean, I think some of us have already mentioned some of those collateral consequences to reentry. I would say the top ones from, you know, from our work and working with women have been safe housing, food, healthy food, and employment, career development, access to high quality education, entrepreneurship training and development, and then of course the policies that are aligned with them. I know that recently I've been told there's about 44,000 barriers to people returning home from prison and jails in this country. So you can't begin to think about what any of them are. 44,000, that's an awful, a lot of barriers. You know, just like simply from a person wanting to take their child to school and join the PTA, can't do that in some jurisdictions. I could not get life insurance myself. And I'm like, well, why? Well, because you were in prison. I'm like, well, what does that have to do with now? Well, because of the conditions that you were once living in, I'm like, okay, well, I'm glad that you realize that you shouldn't put people in cages and that could also, you know, harm them as far as their health is concerned. Yet, if something happened to me, that burden would fall on my family because I can't have a life insurance policy. And went through all the major life insurance companies. I mean, outside of jobs, you know, we have policy that changes or employment. And yes, we remove the box on applications for employment, but people still consent to a background check. And so they'll get a conditional acceptance for employment, and then they'll work there. And then when the background check comes back, it's retracted. And then, you know, there's a cycle again. There's also voting. You know, I know there's some misinformation around voting depending state to state. When I was sentenced, and I was sentenced federally out of Virginia, in my plea, it said that I could no longer vote at all. Like my lifetime, it was taken away. When I got back to New York, in New York State, federally, and being on federal supervision, I could vote. Though my federal supervision officer didn't understand that, they told me I couldn't. But when I went on their website and talked to my attorney, I could. So it is a lot of misinformation about things that you can and cannot do with a small business association or starting businesses. I went to get a small business loan for a for-profit business I wanted to start when I came home, and they asked the question on that, have you ever been convicted of a crime? And I wanted to buy into a franchise. I said, why does that matter if I'm paying in, you know, into this business? If you had a conviction, they didn't even want to look at your application. So those are just some of the barriers that people overall have when they come home. I know for women specifically, again, it's, you know, getting their children back, reuniting with family. I didn't even talk about education applications for college applications or different other educational programs with, again, the checking of the box. When I look at in New York, if your children are under a certain age and different genders, you have to have separate bedrooms for them. So when you think about the likelihood for a mother in New York City who's recently returning home from prison, having a son and a daughter, both under the age of 9, needing a 2-bedroom apartment because the daughter can stay with her, but the son has to have their own, how affordable is that when it's not affordable even to have a studio apartment in usually a safe community in New York City? So these are all the barriers. For the Ladies of Hope Ministries and how we approach the work, we look at the work through 2 different lenses. We say our vision is EPIC, EPIC standing for Ending Poverty and Incarceration of Women and Girls. What we know is that you cannot address the issues or end incarceration unless you address the issues of poverty, the systemic issues of poverty. And so we feel that, you know, you have to make sure that people's basic human rights are met. And that's why we have direct service and sustainability, which is one of our pillars, which is Hope House, our safe housing place, which is in New York and also in New Orleans. And we're scaling that around the country. Also, we have Angel Food Project, which is a partnership with Whole Foods, Fairway, through Instacart, Wegmans, and other supermarkets where we give out fresh bags of donations, groceries to families impacted by incarceration. Pathways for Equity, which is our newest program, partnership with Virgin Unite, where we're partnering with 450 corporations around the globe to ensure second chance employment opportunities through fellowships and Fortune 500 companies, where people have an opportunity to learn about corporate America, learn about different opportunities they have, and then through a paid fellowship, then have the opportunity to then work there full time. And then we have our policy and advocacy work, where we have our Faces of Women in Prison program, which is a global speakers bureau that we just graduated our last cohort last month and are actually accepting applications now through October 31st for our next cohort, where we train women on how to use their voice and tell their story to change policy and other regulations and legislation, and also to get paid as public speakers. So often people who are formerly incarcerated are not valued for their voice, valued for their stories, valued for their time. And it's important that when people are building careers in public speaking and utilizing their expertise, that they are being compensated as such. And so we're ensuring that through the Speakers Bureau. And then EPIC Ambassadors is our last program, where we teach women and impacted and incarcerated women how to draft legislation, partnering with other co-sponsors of bills, learning that whole process, and then ultimately wanting to partner them with different lobby firms so they can become registered lobbyists. And I learned that process because doing a lot of the legislative advocacy work is what it's called, where people are going to the Capitol, beating the street, if you will, and doing these things, they're not getting paid, but they're the ones that are actually changing the hearts and minds of these legislators who are actually going to pass the legislation. So why shouldn't people be compensated? You know, when I work with lobby firms and they're on retainer for $10,000 a month, but the advocates are the ones doing the most of the work, there is a huge gap, you know? And so we can't continue to perpetuate these systems of inequity if within our systems we aren't creating equitable opportunities. And so that's how we're approaching the work. We know that we have to change laws. That's the only way to get to the root issues that have been happening in this country forever. But I can't begin to think about advocating for myself or someone else if I don't have food to eat, a safe place to sleep, and a job.
So basically, it's Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Jeff and then Nomi, could you answer that question also?
Sure. So I agree with Topeka. First of all, there are well over 44,000 barriers to incarceration and coming home. And you know, we have to. The way we approach reentry is really very simple. We want to wear very different glasses. And when you come home from prison and when you work in reentry space, I want you to consciously take your glasses off and then put on a new pair of glasses that looks at life and the things that are going on in society from the perspective of a returning citizen. And oftentimes we have people making policy decisions, making legislation that have never gone this journey, that don't know the right questions to ask because they don't really know the issues. There's a great saying, those closest to the problem are closest to the solution. And men and women that have that have lived experience are the ones that guide our program, because they're the ones that can help people navigate when they come home. Very simple things. How difficult is it when someone comes home and the first thing we tell them is, you got to go get a job. You got to get a job. You got to work. And we say, go over there on the corner and go on that and file an application online. Now, these are men and women sometimes that have been down decades and don't even know what a mouse looks like or how to navigate a computer. And we're asking them to get online and to drag and drop things and do things that we have trouble doing. So we have to start thinking about things in the perspective of the returning citizen, and digital literacy and education and skill development are the things that hold the key, because we have to bring people up to speed with what's going on in our society currently. And if we don't do that, then we're setting them up for failure. And that's a really important thing to understand, especially with COVID-19. You know, we have men and women coming home, and you know, in some instances, they're being released because of the challenges that are happening behind our walls, although not enough are coming home. But yet they're coming home with very few resources. And we have to think about ways that we can engage. I also believe this reentry and the world of reentry it takes a village to fix some of the problems that are out there. And we're proud partners with organizations like Temple University and the Lenfest Foundation. And I know some people from Temple are on the call tonight, but they understand that it's reaching out to the community and really finding out, how can we help? How can we support you and provide those services? And asking returning citizens, what do you need? Because quite honestly, if you asked me when I came home what I needed, I came home with $20 in my pocket on a debit card. I needed money to be able to get to City Hall on a SEPTA pass, a transportation pass. I needed money just to survive and clothing. So that's how we approach reentry. And we do it very holistically, like Heather said, and that's the approach.
Nomi?
Yeah, so everyone has spoken very eloquently about the many, many barriers and the collateral consequences. And where Voices comes in and our approach is really about educating people who have no idea about those many barriers and the collateral consequences. Most people who don't have any direct experience with incarceration, if they think about returning home from prison at all, they envision something that they saw on television or in a movie. So it's either the joyful reunion outside the prison gates, or going home and having a big party, but they have no idea what the next day is like, and about needing to get a job and needing to get, a driver's license and not having money to go down to get a driver's license, and the many, many, many barriers. Or the other kind of narrative that people might have in their head has to do with the failed reentry. There's a lot of documentaries out there that really focus on how hard it is to return successfully. And there's, they follow people and highlight the many barriers, but they set it up in such a way that it sort of makes it seem like people are destined to failure. And so our approach to reentry, our project's purpose, is really to disrupt these narratives, both the narrative that really doesn't really ask questions about what reentry entails and the day-to-day and the barriers, and also disrupts the narrative about the, inevitability of failure, by giving people an opportunity to listen to the stories of returning citizens, to hear firsthand from returning citizens, and to have a dialogue about what reentry looks like and broaden their understanding. So to your point, Jeffrey, about asking people what they need, that's exactly the project that we're engaged in, is bringing people together so that they can really ask those questions and listen to those stories.
Thank you all.
Yes, thank you all so much for that. It's just, conversations like these prove why they're so useful, so we can get a better insight into what reentry is, how we can approach it as individuals. And also thank you all for clarifying and confirming that it's much deeper than, getting clothes and getting a job. It's like having to live with that stigma and like with kind of like that number still on you. And that's just how people treat you in society. And it's just, thank you all so much for that insight and for that information. It gives us a better job or a better, it gives us better strategies on how we can approach the issue as those who have not been incarcerated. So thank you for that. And we'll also speak more about that at the end. But right now, we want to talk a little bit about COVID-19 and how it's had an impact on reentry in general. So we are in the midst of a pandemic and a lot of things have changed. So that being said, Heather and Jeff, could you all talk to us about how COVID-19 has impacted the whole reentry process?
Go ahead, Heather.
Thanks. it's impacted a lot, that's for sure. I think it's a loaded question. We, on an individual basis, so I can speak most, you know, eloquently about what has happened in Rhode Island, but I know that there's certainly parallels to how it's impacted the rest of the country. You know, when COVID first hit, facilities shut down and the outside world was not let in, specifically because it's such a dangerous place, people living in proximity and the risk of spreading the disease. And so what that meant for folks on the inside was not having access to programs and services, not having access to people that were their supports that were coming in from the outside communities, not having visitations. And then from a reentry perspective, that continuity of care of things happening pre-release, driving and leading to the post-release experience were extremely limited. And then on a very practical level here, again in Rhode Island, and I know that it was across the country, people are released to homelessness from prison quite frequently. And one of the responses from the kind of public health perspective was trying to utilize hotels for this part of the population. And it just was like an incredibly complex thing for, I think, each state and each jurisdiction to figure out of how to reduce the amount of people being released to homelessness. And so what it did was it really kind of escalated or exacerbated all of the problems that have already been in existence in the criminal justice system and in corrections for decades. COVID kind of brought them all to the surface. And, you know, another aspect of that is diversion, I think. There was a big movement here and in other places to try to prevent people from being incarcerated in the first place so that you're not adding more folks into the very complicated environment, contained environment. And so we've seen a lot of folks that would typically be arrested and incarcerated not get arrested and incarcerated, which is certainly a good thing. Whether that's happening on a temporary basis or whether it's actually, you know, driving systemic change is still to be seen. And then also there was a big movement again, I think across the country for people to be released early to try to loosen up the numbers in prisons and make sure that people could be as socially distant as possible. But again, all of those other barriers of like, well, if we're releasing people, where are we releasing them to? How are they accessing testing if they're, if they're potentially been exposed. And then there's, because everybody's operating remotely and there's no people, you know, no services in person necessarily, then how do people access the actual services and supports that they need on a daily basis? So we, you know, for our collaborative that I'm helping lead, it really, you know, our entire model was about trying to produce a continuity of care between pre and post release and making sure that folks had deep connections and relationships to continue getting the support that they needed. Once we weren't allowed into facilities, we had to completely change our operations to really only deal with somebody as soon as they walk out the door, because that pre-release access wasn't available. So, I'll stop there. I feel like I just talked for a long time. Jump in, Jeff. Yeah.
So there's a lot to this. First of all, I think this is bittersweet. The bittersweet is that we are getting some relief for people coming home inside of prison because of COVID-19. The bitter part is that we're not prepared enough for those people coming home. We don't have, all of our agencies aren't open. We've seen more drug addiction issues coming up and suicides coming back and all these challenges. What do we really think is going to happen by letting people home without helping them, without giving them some guidance and some direction? So it definitely is very bittersweet. There's also another component we really haven't talked about, is that we have a vocational training program at JEVS inside of the Philadelphia County prisons. And we do all training at all the prisons up on State Road in Philadelphia. And we're really mindful of the reality that men and women are now sitting behind bars and literally 24/7 with very little academic support, educational help or support, vocational training, and things that they need to help get back into society. And yet we're getting ready to release them. We are about in November 4th in New Jersey. We're going to see an onslaught of about 3,000 men and women coming home from prison. In one day, you know, in a very short time frame, and yet we have done very little, I think, at a state level, and certainly nothing at a federal level to help set the stage for what happens next. I mean, I don't think it's rocket science. If you bring someone home and you don't provide any support, what we think is going to happen, and I really think that's we have to start thinking that way better. We have to start planning and being able to prepare for the inevitable. I also think there's a lot of challenges with COVID-19 from an employment perspective. We have right now that it was 27% unemployment rate for returning citizens prior to COVID-19. That's higher than the peak of the Great Depression. Just to put it in perspective, we're only at 8% now in our country, and we have so many people unemployed and underemployed. So the challenge with men and women coming home is that they're now competing against all those people that don't have criminal backgrounds. And I know I can get on a ban the box soapbox, but Topeka mentioned that there is some legislation called ban the box out there. But quite honestly, there's studies out there. It was one University of Michigan that points out ban the box has a very different consequence than we thought, because people end up making assumptions and on the way people look. And it's not about ban the box. It's about leveling the playing field across the board for anyone that comes in for a job. And let's start looking at the skill set that they have. And are they ready to work? Are they, you know, going to be on time? Are they going to be hardworking? And are they going to be able to progress? You know, we haven't even touched the issue of wages and wage parity for a returning citizen. But quite honestly, I think the days of putting someone into a fast food job and that they don't want to be at is oftentimes the very worst thing that could ever happen for a returning citizen, because they get that first check and they buy that cell phone, that new iPhone that they wanted. And they start, the next check, they get an apartment and they start getting responsibility. And in 2 or 3 months, when they're done frying fries or flipping burgers, they're coming back to me and say, Mr. A, I need a job. I can't do that anymore. We have to start targeting people to career opportunities and make life not about the placement of a job, but the retention of the job, getting them into those careers.
So this will be my last question before we shift over to the audience. I wanna ask a question that may seem like crazy. We talked about like when reentry should begin, but when does the reentry process end? Like, does it ever end? Topeka, can you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yeah, it appears that it doesn't ever end. And I just say that because I was on a call with someone today who had been home 17 years. She actually has her doctorate and is still working the same job she has worked for the last 17 years. Her first job out of prison, at an automobile shop, and she is still working there with her doctorate. Still having problems trying to find other employment because of her conviction 17 years ago. Again, housing issues. We've had women who live in our house who've been home 20 years because something happens. Either this one sister's case, she had basically a slumlord and it was ceilings were coming down, you know, and it was nowhere for her to live. And when she tried to find other places to live, they asked her about her background. She checked the box, it comes back. She can't find a place. So, you know, I think, you know, I would like to say it ends. You know, I'm home 5 years and I spoke about what I go through, even when I'm coming back in the country, or other barriers and situations, even as it relates to being a formerly incarcerated woman of color who founded and runs an organization. You know, the barriers that we have to fundraising, to what equity looks like in building our organizations, what people think we should do and be able to produce with limited funds versus what we need in order to truly have sustainable businesses. So, you know, I would love to say one day that once you've served your time and completed whatever that may be, that it's over and you can truly start your life over anew. But I don't see that happening now. I don't know if anyone else disagrees. And I don't foresee in any immediate future that it would change, because outside of that, I heard someone mentioning earlier about the psychological barriers. You know, for me, I came home and I knew I was redeemed through God, and I did not carry, and I don't carry my conviction. So I never looked at it as a barrier for me, ever. But there are many people that walk around because of cognitively the way they think about it and how you move, because there's this scarlet letter on your chest or your back or your head. And the fact that when you're going through probation or parole and you tell them of your aspirations and they tell you, no, you cannot do this and you cannot do that, or you can't work this job or you can't start this business. And so you really end up dumbing yourself down, if you will, just to meet the minimum requirements to appease other people. And a lot of times it keeps you through this vicious cycle of not being able to just get out of that frame of mind and that mindset. So I think there is always going to be a barrier, whether it is emotionally, spiritually, cognitively, physically, through what's happening in this system. That's my personal opinion, but I would love to hear what others have to say about that.
If we can get one more person to answer that, and then we'll move on to the audience questions. So the question is like, when does reentry end, or does it ever end?
It doesn't end. It doesn't end. And in some ways I don't want it to end, because it reminds me, I'm really humbled at where the position I sit in now, but it also reminds me of the past and the journey and the lessons that I had in the past. But, you know, the reality is I've seen people that have had high school, did something really silly in high school that they got arrested for. And 25, 30 years later, it's coming back now to haunt them because they can't get a job on a background check that comes back. So I think it's always out there in some form or fashion. And it is definitely, Tabika is completely right. It's a mindset. You know, you have to think positive and you have to be willing to push forward and, you know, and value yourself and have that self-confidence to know that, you know, you're that of what your worth is and stay true to that. But I don't think it ever really will end.
I was going to say, I think, you know, until we stop doing background checks, or fill in the blank, right? There won't be a possibility for reentry to end per se, because that's, you know, that's built into so many pieces of our society. And, you know, on a practical level, just for those that are really new to thinking about reentry, it's also important, or the reentry process ending, that community supervision. So if somebody's released on probation or parole, is an extension to some extent of somebody's sentence, parole particularly, or, you know, like it's the original sentence, but there's so much more potential for folks to continue to be reincarcerated and experience a real high level of those struggles if they're actively being supervised by probation or parole. Certainly afterwards as well, but I think, you know, just recognizing that that is a piece of reentry, as well as there's mandates and conditions that are imposed on people that they may or may not need, but that's what the system says they need, and that directly has an impact on the reentry process as well.
Thank you all for that. So I have a couple of audience questions here, and, you know, you don't have to answer all of them. Not everyone has to answer all of them, so answer the best answer the ones that you think that you have the most experience in. And so the first question is, what role does the political climate play in the process of reentry? And so I guess if I can reframe that is, you know, how much is the political climate or the, how much does that impact reentry, say, you know, from a state level or a federal level, you know, there's winds of change, and how much does do those politics impact, you know, the reentry field or the reentry process?
So I guess I can start. It has a huge impact. I mean, the political impact, the political climate of our country and the work that's being done at both a state and federal level is really guided by what our politicians deem important and what we're advocating for. You know, if you told me a few years ago that I would see the movement that we have in everything from occupational licensing restrictions that are now being changed and Pell Grant discussions at a Washington level where we have an opportunity to re-engage at the Pell Grant for returning citizens and for those that are incarcerated. It definitely is guided by it. And, you know, we are really on the cusp. We've come so far when it comes to criminal justice reform, and the ball needs to keep rolling. We need to recognize that, you know, there's so much more that can be done. And the Second Chance Act was wonderful, but to be honest with you, you know, it touches such a small percentage of our incarcerated population. You know, most of our the people that are incarcerated are at a state and county level. So we need to start looking at things like bail reform and diversion programs and really engaging in skill development inside, and then how we help people leap from the inside to the out. And a lot of that is guided by our political climate, because now it's more acceptable for a politician to say, I think we need to ban the box piece of legislation, or we need to look at licensing restrictions again, and we need to start chipping away at them. And years ago, it just wouldn't have been something that would have even been on the table. And I also think you're seeing a lot of returning citizens now, like Topeka and myself, and a lot of people with lived experience stepping up and saying, it's okay, this was our journey, and now we're gonna be an advocate, and we're gonna try and effectuate change. As a matter of fact, I was with Topeka in Washington last year, and she spoke at, I think it's the National Skills Coalition, or at one of the conferences in Washington, and very impactful, but we had people really listening, and that I think is guided by the political climate, that there people are ready for change, and our legislators are beginning to hear it.
I would add also to that if you just look historically at the field of reentry and just look again kind of where we're at compared to where we've been, really reentry as a field didn't exist before mass incarceration and the war on drugs. Really what happened was the prisons became overcrowded, and the politicians and state budgets and everything else really said, oh crap, we have to figure out how to keep people out because we don't have any more room in, and it's really expensive. And so it wasn't really until the mid-90s when research and any evidence was kind of built about how to keep people out of prison. And a lot of that research really focuses on individual criminogenic need and risk, and is really about how do you keep the individual from committing further crimes. It's not necessarily about how does the system work, how do the politicians work, how do the legislators work better. And that's, we still got a long way to go in terms of how to actually effectively reform reentry systems and the criminal justice system. And so if you know, we've only got 15, 20 years really of pure empirical evidence to even show what works. So we've got a long way to go still, I think. And that certainly does, you know, it's shifted and impacted by the political climate and interests. And thankfully, you know, I think criminal justice reform is a bipartisan issue that has stayed that way for quite a while. Hopefully it will continue to, but there's certainly a long way to go, I think.
Cool. Thank you all for those answers. So this next question actually hits home for me personally for two reasons. One, I'm currently in school. I just graduated from Howard this year, and I'm in grad school right now. And also I have an immediate family member who was released from prison in April due to COVID-19, and how they were releasing some people early. And so I really do think that this will help me. But the question is, what can college graduate students do in the age of COVID-19 to volunteer with reentry related issues, especially with so many volunteer programs being paused?
Well, one, welcome home to your loved one. Let me say that to you. I know how difficult it can be. So if you need any type of support, I'm here. I just want to say that. But a lot of times we have different organizations or students reaching out to us and asking how they can support. For us, it's helping to share and lift, whether it's through your school newsletter or blog, the stories of impacted people, you know, telling what their experience during this time to help to educate your network even more. That's one way. The other way is people volunteer with us by helping to give out some of the food donations, even during COVID, helping to mentor some of the people coming home through Zoom or other platforms, teaching people how to, you know, write their resumes, how just other life skills or basic skills that people need. We had a sister who volunteered to help a woman with her GED. She needed some additional support that way. I think each individual organization and each person who's coming home will need something different. Sometimes people are used to, while they're incarcerating, having a correspondence buddy, right? Maybe it's somebody that they can just talk to tell, like, this is what I'm experiencing. And because you have a loved one and know what that experience is like for them, you can be emotional support for them. So, you know, like, there's different ways to support people, different needs that everyone has. You know, sometimes it's something as easy as hygiene products. You know, it's this myth that coming home from prison, you come home with a care package, and or you come home into a place that is providing those things for you. And people don't have toothpaste, soap, basic hygiene products. You know, maybe there's something that you can do within your school to get them to help to facilitate a donation, sanitary pads, and just different things. And the holidays are coming up too, right? You know, you have children who have been out of school because of COVID or doing remote learning. How can you help in supporting the reunification process or the connecting process between mothers and children? So those are just a few ideas based on some of the things that we do, but there are many, many organizations out in your area, outside of your area, that can use your skill set and helping people get the things that they need as they're transitioning out. And then also, I mean, you're already volunteering with this great organization, so whatever additional skills that you can help to provide, I think, you know, others, if you have the time, would also be helpful.
Yeah, so thank you for that, Nia. I wanna, this was an audience question that was submitted beforehand, and I think it hits home for everybody on here, whether they have a history of incarceration or are wanting support. And I'll just get personal, like, I have a family history of incarceration. The stories that I learned for a long time, and that I believe for a long time about my kinfolk who were incarcerated, like, were very anti-Black, were very deficit language, very it's their fault. And really, you know, these are family members who, you know, we think are of burdens and that carry a stigma. And so I think it's important for us to, like, for me to ask, what should we, like, understand about, like, returning, like, the citizens, about, like, this process, and I shouldn't say, like, the difficulty of it, but the we already talked about the challenges, but, like, What do we need to do to break our break the stigmas that we have of returning folks? I hope my question makes sense.
Look, I'm like, it doesn't.
You say what?
I said it doesn't. Now I just want you to just expound a little bit more so that, because I think I understand, but I'm really not
sure. Yeah, so like, let's say this, some of us think that you get out of jail, and Naomi touched on this, you get out of jail and you get out of prison, everything should be all right. And like, why aren't you making progress? Okay. And then some of us got family members that are that have I'm gonna use this word, cycled in and out, and they carry a stigma. And so I think my question is like what is the work that that as a society and just as individuals like we need to do, or what do we need to understand about like what this process is like, and what the
People coming home from prison, what is it like what should society understand about it, like coming home everything isn't okay?
I
could just answer just shortly. I see Jeff unmuted, so I know he has something to add. I mean, I would look at it like, and in college is not the same, but I'm just gonna look at it as college. People go to college, they're away from home, they're at school where they're either living on campus, you know, they get their meals at school, they graduate, they go back home. They still need additional supports, right? Whether it's staying with their family until they get on their feet, whether it's being able to have additional housing, whether it is additional support, because they have not gotten that job yet or that next step in life in order to begin to take care of themselves. Coming home from prison, I remember coming home from prison, and the first month I was home, I mean, one of my greatest friends, she had a business, so she hired me like very minimum wage just so that I can get out the halfway house. And I was going to seminary school during the day. But I remember laughing because I'm like, okay, all the money that my family sent in every single month while I was there, when I came home that first month, that money was gone. And I remember saying to one of my family members, like, I still need that $100 that you sent in to me. Like, I know because I'm working, but even the amount of money, because I was well-resourced. I had really great support while I was inside. The amount of money that I made was not a lot, $100 a month, and I had a high-paying job in federal prison working for Unicor. But the additional money that my family and friends sent when I came home and now having to buy a Metro card or, you know, take a cab in certain places depending on the time, or buy food, buy, wash my clothes, everything cost. And they thought, well, oh, they didn't realize like at all, right, that I needed additional support in that way, because they're like, oh, she's home and she's working, that she's okay. And I had to have that conversation, even the emotional support. Having to go to therapy. I went to therapy once a week, every single week, for my first year home, because even though it was only 3 years, it was a huge shift and shock. And I can only imagine some of the sisters that have been in 20 years that I had to take to the subway to show them how to use a Metro card, because when they left, there were tokens. Or how to use an ATM machine, because there wasn't ATMs then. And like all of these things. So I think, or another example, one of my employees just left, but she was saying how when she just came home, she would go to the library to use the computer. Mind you, got her bachelor's degree when she was incarcerated, but didn't know how to use the computer when she came home. Went to the library, and the librarian was very nasty to her because they didn't understand how she didn't know how to use the computer to print out what she needed. So, I mean, I share these things to say that, you know, like these are concrete examples on how we as a society need to be more empathetic, understanding that when you come from one environment, irrespective to what it is, but think about coming from a very traumatic environment that is very dark and having to find your way through light. You need love, you need support, you need consideration, you need compassion. And without those things, you will emotionally and psychologically continue to be met with different barriers, even the internal barriers and demons. Like we all, I mean, I'm sure Jeff can attest, like there are dark moments. You know, like today I was so emotional. And I was just like, I don't know why I'm crying. Like, why am I feeling like this? And I've been home 5 years. But when we're doing this work and we're reliving these experiences and talking about these things every day in order to get, to your point, society to understand the impacts that those dark moments had on one's life without getting resources in order to transform, that you have, you're stuck in these moments. And without that instrumental and emotional support, you will be, I mean, you'll go down this continued cycle of really self-abuse, unfortunately. So I hope that answered your question a little bit.
It did. And we got to go on, but I would reframe it as, what does grace and empathy look like? That would be the and you answered that. Jeff, unfortunately, we got to transition out. Yeah. But this conversation can continue on Twitter, and we'll have more conversations. Thank you all. Marie is going to give us some instructions, and then we'll go ahead and head out.
Yeah, thanks everyone so much for your attendance tonight. Just want to take a moment to really reflect on the steps that you're taking to learn about reentry. We're really thankful for your participation in our webinar tonight. Before you go, just a few quick notes. A web browser is going to pop up after this with a survey. We really do read the survey and we implement your suggestions every round of webinars. And please follow us on social media. We're here at Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. And we also rely on support from folks like you or your networks to make these webinars possible and to provide our programming. And together we can reimagine the criminal legal system. So we have here our PayPal thing that you can scan with your camera on your phone or our website. We appreciate any support you can give or just sharing our work on social media. Our next webinar is on November 18th. And that's Reentry in Education. We'll hear from students who've received Petey Greene Program tutoring and also other educational opportunities inside. And you can register now for that on our website. And here's here our registration process. You can scroll down. And register there. Again, we thank you so much for your participation in the program and for being here tonight. We're really, really thankful for everyone coming out, the panelists and Nia and Mako for moderating. And before we go, we just wanna get one more visual of the panelists here. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. Thank you so much, everyone. We really, really appreciate your participation.